Peace to the gods, peace to the hosts. Shout out to you, peace to the man. To sun, moon, and star. Check your PM, man, woman, and child. Keep off your time, man. Acknowledge this, God. She's trying to steal your glory. Shout out to you, Seth, man. Peace to the gods. Peace in the supreme mathematics. Acknowledge this, God.
16-5, 1-3-5, supreme mathematics that spell peace, God. But in times of peace, I'm preparing for war with a Mashiach 144. The end is near, better sin no more. You better not sin no more, no more. You better not sin no more. 16-5, 1-3-5, supreme mathematics that spell peace, God. But in times of peace, I'm preparing for war with a Mashiach 144. The end is near, better sin no more. You better not sin no more, no more. You better not sin no more. Death to lady boys eating too much soy. Women's liberation made sissy boys. Social media hoes get to swore to the Lord. Say you don't need a man, too masculine. Independent women are only fans.
Shalom. Mashamcha. Mashlameh. My appellation can be referred to as Kahan Tazadok, the deprogram enlightener, Kahan Tazadok Shah. Tazadok Shabay. Pick one. Choose one. I am not the name. That is just a way to summons the attention of Kahan Tazadok. I'm not of this world. Within a particular dispensation of time, I was sent here to deprogram and enlighten a certain faction of people that could receive this truth. Now, I know this sounds bizarre, sounds strange, because many of you are not in the correct place mentally, nor do you have the mental capacity to comprehend, to understand, stand within the realms of the dimension that I'm about to take your mind into. Some of you won't make it off of this demented sphere that they have you confined in. This is an ideological war that I am attempting to help you overcome. I'm not of this world. I was sent here. I'm a star seed. The scriptures read Abraham's seeds would be like the stars. I contend that I'm one of those seeds. If I told you my true age, you would be astonished. But I'm here to tell you that I'm akin to Aleph Tav. In the Greek, that was the Ibrit. In the Greek, you may say Alpha and Omega. In the Ibrit, I say Aleph Tav. The beginning and the end. I'm one who was sent. And this is right knowledge for real. You hear people using the phrase loosely, but can't comprehend it. I'm here to tell you today about the evil noise, the album noise. I elect to use those particular appellations to describe people in society to avoid censorship. Because the information that I'm about to present, certain powers that be, who's actually reached the zenith of their rule and are now in a decline, knew and anticipate my arrival. Most of you just don't know who I am. I'm not what they say I am. Here, I am. Now, thousands of years ago on the planet that we call Eretz, and that you call Earth, the planet was visited by various extraterrestrial humanoids, beings, who had to leave their planet and seek refuge on Earth because their home planet had actually been destroyed by evil. Now, when these extraterrestrial humanoids, beings, arrive on Eretz, they chose to take residence inside the center of the earth. Yeah, I know that sounds far-fetched. I'm gonna ask you to attempt to maintain an open mind, because this is gonna floor many of you. And those that have the capacity, get back up off of the floor. Because the surface of the earth was inhabited by what you have been taught it are human beings. Now, at this point in time, Earth's history, human beings who live on the surface of the earth were all of one tribe, Ebonoids. If you're not familiar with that term, you, melanated man, the Asiatic man that they refer to as the black man. I refer to you as the Asiatic black man. You say, wait a minute, Kahan tells the doc I'm not from Asia. If time permits, I'll teach you about Asia Major. They always taught you about Asia Minor, but they never taught you about Asia Major. But I'll go into that if it is the will of the Ruach HaKadosh a bit later. I digress. So the earth was of all one tribe, the Ebonoid tribe, right? Now, since they live inside the earth, these extraterrestrial beings, E.T., thus the movie E.T., right? They say it's all, well, it's just a movie. No, it's not just a movie. People have seen sightings of unidentified flying objects coming to this planet. But I can identify with them. Because if I told you where I came from, you wouldn't believe me. So I won't. You think you know me, but you have no idea. You know of me, but you don't know me. Here I am. I pray that you can receive the right knowledge, because it's didactic. This is not just knowledge, this is right knowledge. So since they've actually lived inside of the earth, these extraterrestrials, ETs, have now became interterrestrial beings, because we lived in the earth. ETs, ITs. You had ETs that became ITs. So the center of the earth where these ITs, interterrestrials, reside also contains an inner sun. The inner earth has been called by a variety of names by cultures around the world, including Shambhala by Buddhists, Agatha by Tibetans, Kanuji by the ancient Mesopotamians, Dua and Amenta by the ancient Egyptians, Hades or the underworld by Europeans, ex Bambala by the Mayans. And in modern times, the concept of the inner earth has given rise to what is called the hollow earth theory. You see, the man that Yakub manufactured has always stole our information and claimed it as his own. Unbeit known to many human beings, the activities of these beings which reside inside the earth has affected the course of human history and human development. You were never taught it as. The first and most noble of the beings which resides inside the earth, they're called the Shayuk people. The Shayuk people. Compared to human beings, these Shayuks were considered to be geniuses. With exceptional intellectual abilities and quasi-telepathic telekinesis abilities, the Chinook have a dark brown skin complexion like me. They're between 5 feet and 7 feet tall, and their heads, brains, and cranium capacity is much wider and larger than the average human brain. The Chinook come to the Earth's surface occasionally to teach and trade with certain tribes of human beings. Thus, why am I here? This is why I'm here. The teachings of the Chinook are also profound. They're so profound that when they come to the Earth's surface to teach, they are called deities, gods, priests. Thus, Gohan tells the doc, prophets, messengers, and seers. And because of this fact, the Chinook have strict laws which limit the interaction of the tribal members' contact with humans on the surface. The Chinook commonly interacts and have mixed in with the surface humans called the Danakil. These are also known as the Afar people. In present-day Eritrea, Djibouti, Ethiopia, and Somalia. The chief of the Chinook is named King Thiokwa, and his daughter, Princess Redia, and two of his brothers, Amo and Yishak, who've actually always been jealous of his brother, King Thiokwa. King Thiokwa's brother, Amo, had fallen in love with a surface-dwelling human female. And he would sneak to the surface of the earth to visit her, and would also pass himself off to the surface-dwelling humans as a psychic and a magician. And for these acts, Emma was exiled to live on the surface, 20 miles outside of the present-day city, Mecca, in Saudi Arabia. Heed the knowledge, God. As long as the people in the inner earth spent most of their life in the inner earth, they will not die. They were immortal. However, to be exiled to the surface world means a person from the inner earth would eventually die like the mortals on the surface. In the caravans adjacent to the Chinook resides another group of nobles. That's what I'm going to talk to you about. There's also another noble group called the Sinin. The Sinins are highly intelligent, but they also have a fighting spirit. The Sinins are typically between 5 feet and 7 feet tall, and they have a variety of complexions, ranging from yellow to brown. Remember, there's 16 shades to black, man. Through the knowledge, through my wisdom, right? And they are hairless and are mostly noted for their comb-shaped heads. Now, you've seen this in the Twilight Zone, and you've seen Esau put this on his television shows and in movies, so it's an attempt to dumb you down so you could think, hey, it was just a movie. The Sinins are commonly have actually interact with the surface world humans, including people like the ancient Egyptians, the Amleks, and in present-day Central America, the Mangbatu people in the African Congo, and the Parcas people in Peru. Now, the chief of the Sinins is the King Lamasa, and his daughter, Princess Lucina. And he actually also has a son named Prince Hatif. Now, one of the wretched groups of beings which actually resides inside the earth is called the Simon, right? The Simons are gluttonous, they're beasts, they're pale, with long elephant-like noses, and they're very, very negative and very aggressive. The Simon were eventually the manifest evil grafted out of the sinning, on their home world prior to being arriving here on earth. Now, since the Simon was actually grafted out of the sinning, It is the responsibility of the sinning to police and keep in check the evil activities of discernment. It is said that an American named Richard Sharp Shaver and Koenig a singing and called them a teros, meaning an interrogative robot. And he encountered a Simon and called him a Duros, meaning a detrimental robot. Now one day the wretch Simonian raided and invaded the village of Chinook, stealing food and terrorizing the Chinook family. When King Fouquar learned of this invasion by the Simon, he sent the telegraphic message to King Lamsa, stating that the Simon has neglected their responsibility to keep the Simon in check, because the Simon was currently raiding and invading the village of Chinook. And upon receiving the telepathic message from King Fuqua, King Lamsa went with his brethren to the caravans of the Chinook to stop the invasion by the Simon, and to drive the Simon back to whence they came. After driving the Simon away from the lands of the Chinook, King Lamsa apologized to King Fuqua, but tension remained between the Chinook and the Simon for some time after that incident. Now, in order to make peace between the Chinook and the Simon, King Lamsa offered his daughter, Princess Lucina, to be a wife of King Fuqua. King Fuqua accepted the peace offering from King Lamsa, and in turn offered his daughter, Princess Ridaya, to be the wife of King Lamsa's son, Prince Hatif, as the custom. And there was peace in the land for some time between the two tribes of Chinook and Sinni. But King Lamsa's daughter, Princess Lucina, was angered and rage because she did not want her father to give her away to be the wife of the Chinook King Fuqua, because she felt as an outcast and out of place living amongst the Chinook people. And she did not like living by the strict laws of the Chinook people. And she always wanted to marry a man from her own people, the Sinni. Now one day, Princess Lucina, now the unhappy wife of King Fuqua, met Yishak, the jealous brother of King Fuqua. And they conspired together based on their hatred for King Fuqua to have an illicit sexual affair together behind the back of the King Fuq. Princess Lucina and Yeshua would travel to the surface world, to the home of Amar, the exiled brother of King Fuqua and Yeshua, and it was here where they would have an illicit affair. This affair between Princess Lucina and Yeshua went on for months, with them sneaking back and forth from the inner earth to the surface world, and eventually Princess Lucina became pregnant. In a pregnant state, Princess Lucina would not return to the land of the inner earth, but would remain at home at the home of Emma and Yeshua would stay with her. Now it was here in the home of Emma, 20 miles outside of the present-day city of Mecca, Saudi Arabia, where the child Yakub was born to Yeshua and Princess Lucina. The child Yakub being a part of the Chinook and part of the Sinin had an enormous head, the size of two men's head, and he also had two brains. Knowing that they could not return to the inner earth because their affair had not produced a child, Yeshua and Princess Lucina decided to live and raise the baby Yakub for 5 years in the home of Ammo, 20 miles outside of the present-day city of Mecca, Saudi Arabia. Yakub's father, Yeshua, would work as a scientist and a priest. He was working among the humans on the surface, calling himself Mornorkin. You caught that, right? Mornorkin, the last high priest. Now, back in the inner earth, Yeshua and Princess Lucina had been missing for years, and eventually it was found out by King Fuqua about the affair between Princess Lucina and his brother Yeshua. King Fuqua ordered his soldiers to go to the home of his brother Ammo and arrest Yeshua for his crime, and according to the laws of the Chinook, Yeshua was put to death. Princess Lucina's life was actually spared because she now had a young child to take care of, but her punishment was to remain exiled to the surface world, living in the home of Ammo, and to never return to the inner earth. Depressed about her inability to return home, overwhelmed by her responsibilities to raise a child, and saddened by the death of her lover Yeshua, Princess Lucina kills herself by committing suicide. The 5-year-old child, Yakub, now orphaned, is raised by his uncle, Emma. And the child, Yakub, is emotionally disturbed and rebellious because of the death of his parents. The child grows to hate his people, the Chinook, and all dark complexion people, and he blames them for the death of his parents. And the desire to have his revenge when he grows up. The child Yakub starts school at the age of 4. And he's teased and he's mocked about the size of his head by the surface dwelling human children, creating low self-esteem and further infuriating the already deranged Yakub, fueling his desire for revenge. Yakub's uncle Emma would tell Yakub stories about the beings in the inner earth and how the Samin were the manifestation of evil grafted out of Yakub's mother's family, the Sinin. One day, when Yakub was 6 years old, he was playing with two magnets in the home of his uncle Ammo, and he noticed the magnetic power of attraction and repulsion that other likes attract and likes repel. And by observing this, Yakub was inspired with a determined idea to create a tribe unlike any of the people on the surface of the planet. And this unlike tribe will be weak and wicked, and attract other tribes on the surface of the planet and rule over them. So like it, they would attack other tribes on the planet and rule over them with knowledge of tricks, also known as trick knowledge, for 6,000 years. You know what I told you? 6,000 years. Knowledge of tricks trick knowledge for 6,000 years. Upon coming to the realization, Yakub looked up to his uncle Ammo and he said, "Uncle, when I get to be an old man, I'm going to make a people who shall rule you." End of quote. Uncle Ammo said, "What will you make? Someone to make mischief and cause bloodshed in the land?" Yakub responded to his uncle saying, "Nevertheless, uncle, I know that which you know not. I know that which you know not." Y'all caught that, right? And it was at that moment that the boy Yakub first came into the knowledge of just who he was, born to make trouble, break peace, kill and destroy, and be the enemy to the Ebonoid people of Earth. Yakub knew in order to accomplish his plan, he would have to study science, biology, and genetics. Yakub was a child of prodigy, in school being exceptionally smarter than the surface-dwelling humans he was going to school with. And by the age of 18, Yakub had finished all of the colleges and universities of his nation. While in college, Yakub was a model. He was mocked and teased, being called the big-headed scientist. After graduating from colleges and universities of his nation, Yakub began to preach a new doctrine to people in the city, which was 20 miles outside of the present-day city of Saudi Arabia. Yakub called this new doctrine trick knowledge. I say again, Yakub called this new doctrine trick knowledge. And this holy book was called the Book of Tricknology. Yakub's holy book was called the Book of Tricknology of 120. And he taught if people follow his doctrine, they will be able to rule the world for 6,000 years and make slaves of everyone else on the earth. Yakub made such impressions on the people that many people began following him. The children who once mocked and teased Yakub was now requesting to be part of what he was teaching. The girls who once laughed at Yakub were now women who desired him. As Yakub's teaching spread it, he made more and more converts to his new doctrine. And the power of Yakub's doctrine began to intimidate the king on the surface dwelling humans, who ordered Yakub and his followers to be thrown in prison. The police arrested all of Yakub's followers and put them in prison and filled up all the prison cells with Yakub's followers. But, however, there was not enough space to put Yakub's followers in jail. Therefore, there were still some people who were spreading Yakub's teachings. The police notified the king that they did not have enough space for all of Yakub's followers. At that point, the king decided to go to Yakub's prison cell and negotiate a deal. The king went to Yakub's in his prison cell, and the king said, "Oh, you Mr. Yakub?" Yakub said, "Yes, I am." The king said, "Yakub, I've come to see if we could actually work out an agreement that would actually bring about an end to this trouble. What do you suggest?" Yakub said to the king, "If you give me and my followers everything to start civilization and furnish us with money and other necessities of life for 20 years, I will take my followers and we will leave." The king was pleased with the deal offered by Yakub and agreed to take care of them for 20 years until Yakub's followers were able to go for themselves. After 20 years, the government began to make preparations for the exiling of Yakub and his followers. The king ordered everyone rounded up who was a believer in Yakub's doctrine, and they took them to the seaport and loaded them on ships. Sounds familiar? Y'all caught that, right? They turned around and did that to y'all. You understand what I'm talking about? When Yakub and his followers, remember the transatlantic? Yakub's followers turned around and they did it to y'all. You dig? When Yakub and his followers deported, there was a total of 59,999. That's three sixes upside down plus another six. Plus Yakub making 60,000 total people on his ships. Yakub and his fleet of ships departed from an area 20 miles outside of the present day city Mecca, Saudi Arabia, and they set sail on the Sea of Reeds that many mistakenly refer to as the Red Sea. And they sail all the way around the continent of Africa to go to their destination, which was the area which is currently called the island of Patmos. Patmos, also known in the Bible as Pelam, in the Aegean Sea. While on the ship sailing around Africa to get to that area, which is currently called the island of Patmos, in the Bible referred to once as Pelam, Yakub began the second part of his plan, which was eugenics, human grafting experiment. Now, you don't believe what I'm saying right here because they have your mind blocked. You got your face stuck in a phone. You don't memorize the numbers anymore. You've been dumbed down. But you believe in stem cell research. And you believe in human cloning. Now, what if I told you your mind is so blocked that you cannot believe that Yakub was the first human cloner? You don't want to admit that because he was what you referred to as a black man. But it's a fact. He was the first human cloner. Even though all the people on the surface of the earth were one tribe, the Ebonoid tribe, there were still some variations within the Ebonoid tribe. And Yakub began to highlight these differences. And Yakub thought these people out, and he taught these people that they were special because Yakub planned to use them to graft his new tribe. Yakub developed his theory by studying his own genetics under the microscope, and he noticed that there are two different genes in him, the original man. One gene that was dark from his father, Yitzhak, family, the Chinook, and the other that was not dark from his mother, Princess Lucina's family, the Cyan. Yakub began to have children with the women on the ship, and the babies which were born that were lighter complexion, he would spare their life. But the babies which were born, which were of a darker complexion, Yakub would have thrown overboard in the ships. Yakub felt if he could successfully separate the darker gene from the lighter gene, then he could graft the Ebonoid tribe into its last stage, which would be an Albinoid. Yakub planned to create a tribe of Albinoids, which he discovered was weaker than the Ebonoid gene, which would be unalike, to rule the Ebonoid nation for 6,000 years. When Yakub's followers learned of this new wicked plan and learned that he was killing and throwing babies overboard into the ocean, 95% of his followers lost their loyalty to Yakub and they abandoned the mission and jumped ship. Yakub's fleet of ships sailed around Africa, and the people who lost loyalty to his mission would jump ship into areas which are now known as Egypt, Saudi Arabia, Ethiopia, Kenya, Djibouti, Somalia, Nubia, Senegal, Morocco, Tanzania, and so on and so forth. 10% of the original 60,000 of Yakub's followers betrayed Yakub and jumped ship. 85% of the original 60,000 of Yakub's followers jumped ship because they were confused why he would do such a horrible thing. Leaving only 5% of the original 60,000 of Yakub's followers who were actually made it to the destination of the island of Patmos, also known as Pelam in the Bible, of the Aegean Sea. As king of his island, Yakub set up birth control plan long before Margaret Sanger came out with any kind of birth control plan. Yakub set up Planned Parenthood long before any Margaret Sanger. Yakub set up a birth control and Planned Parenthood laws, which would contribute to his plan of negative eugenics and genocide to breed his Albanoi tribe. Yakub made it a law that only the lighter complexion people could have children. People with darker complexion were put to death. Sounds familiar? Y'all caught that, right? And when the children were born, nurses was ordered to have the darker babies killed by pricking their brains with a sharp needle as soon as the child's head was out of his mother. But the lighter babies were allowed to live. Yakub's aim was to kill and destroy the Ibanoid nation. Yakub would have the dead babies of the Dorker babies fed to the beasts. And if they would not find any wild beasts to feed the bodies to, they would take the dead bodies of the babies to a cremator to be burned. This is the level of intense hatred Yakub had in his heart. This process went on for years on Yakub's island. Yakub trained his sons and grandsons to carry on his work after he died. Yakub died at the age of 150. This knowledge power cipher, all being born to equality. He died of a brain tumor. As the father trick knowledge, the father of trick knowledge, Yakub was the father of trick knowledge. Yakub taught his people a doctrine which would enable them to rule the world for 6,000 years. Yakub also taught his people that God is a spirit and a spook, not a man, just like Yakub's graphic devils teach you today. And Yakub was the founder of the doctrine of unalikes attract. After 200 years on Yakub's island, all the Dorker babies had been done away with, and all the babies were born of a new tribe. I said after 200 years on Yakub's island, all the Dorker babies had been done away with, and all the babies that were born of a new tribe called the Rubidoid tribe. After another 200 years, all the babies born of an even newer tribe called the Citronoid tribe. And finally, after 200 years, which makes 600 years total, all of the babies born on Yakub's island were Yakub's desired Albanoid tribe. Mission accomplished. It took 600 years to breed Yakub's Albanoid tribe. And every imagination of their heart, and all of their actions were wicked continuously. The evilness of the Albanoids not only affected themselves, but also affected the other people of the world. Yakub's Albanoids returned to the city where they were exiled from, 200 Salakia, 20 miles outside a present-day city, Mecca, Saudi Arabia. Once back in the city, it only took 6 months for Yakub's Albanoid to cause chaos and war amongst the Ebonoid people. The king of the Ebonoid people realized that it was Yakub's Ebonoids who was causing all of the trouble. And the king made a decree to drive Yakub's evil Ebonoids from amongst them. The king rounded up all of Yakub's Ebonoids and stripped them of their clothing and put aprons on them. You hear that, right? Caught that, right? See where the Masons get it from? The king rounded up all of Yakub's Ebonoids and stripped them of their clothing and put aprons on them. Just like the Most High did Adam and Eve in the garden. But this is a different kind of Adam right here. This is a devil. This is a grafted man. And Yakub was their God. So he stripped them of their clothing and put aprons on them, just like the Masons, right? To hide their nakedness. And he sent his army with them across the burning sands into a place which is modern day Europe. When a Mason reaches the 33rd degree, if he wants to become a Shriner, he has to cross the burning sands. This is all symbolic to General Monk. General Monk had a sword and he used his army to decapitate any of Yakub's people that would try to cross the burning sands to get back into the city of Mecca. The head would actually be chopped off with the sword. So when a Muslim son, and I'm going to do a lesson on the Muslim son and the Mason sons, right? When a Mason son becomes a Shriner, he has to wear a fez with a sword on it to remember if he step outside of his boundaries, walk with your head with the sword of truth. Don't tell the secret. Netflix did a series called The Burning Sands. This is all taken from this right knowledge right here, showing you that they know the truth, but they put it in a movie or a series. So you can say, after all, it's just a movie. No, it's not just a movie. It's the truth. I'm one who was sent, a seer, a Kahan, a messenger, a prophet, a priest, to give you this right knowledge. I pray that you can receive it. I pray that you can receive it, because I am God. Psalms 82 verse 6. Yakub's Ebonoids were roped into the mountains and caves. The rope was the cable tie. Same thing that you Masons use today. It was the cable tie. The rope represents the cable tow that they was marched in with. The EU represents the caves in the hillside that they fell down to when they got on all fours and became like savage beasts, because we stripped them of our education, clothing. They became uncivilized and they started to mate with dogs. They became Neanderthals. Thus, Neander Valley. It all adds up. They came back using the name Caucasian. Doesn't mean white. This is not racism. It's history. Don't get upset. It means cave dweller. Because they dwelt in the cliff of the rocks. From the Caucasus Mountains. In Georgia, Russia, between the Black and Caspian Sea. This is where they marched at. They became known as Turks. I'm going to get to that. Yakub's Ebonoids were roped into the mountains and caves, and the king's army would patrol the area to make sure Yakub's albumoid stayed in the mountains and caves for 2,000 years to ensure that these people are kept from the Ibanoid people. Now, what do you think happened if you're in a cave for 2,000 years? They needed to survive. This is how the dog became mankind's best friend. But it was a wolf then. It was a wolf then. See, there's no such thing as a regular dog. Again, that is grafting. The dog was grafted from a wolf. The wolf is the original wild animal. As time progressed, these albinoids literally laid with the dogs. The Neanderthals laid with the dogs and they caught diseases, STDs, and they spread it to the Ibanoids. This is how syphilis and STDs got in the world. If you doubt what I'm saying, you do your own damn research on it, and you're gonna find out that everything that the God is saying is right and exact. I know it hurts. You want the truth? Or you want the lie? I understand a Negro loves a lie, but you're not a Negro. You're Ibanoid. Understand who you are. Who's who on the planet Earth? 2,000 years. They was kept away from the Ibanoid people. During the 2,000 year period, in the mountains and caves without anything to start civilization, Yakub's albinoids became shameless, moralless, psychopathic, savage beasts, and lost all sense of shame and started going nude. You call them cavemen today. You call them Neanderthals. And in the winter, they wore animal skins for clothes. And they grew hair all over their bodies and faces like other wild animals. Yakub's albinoids started walking on their hands and their feet. In other words, they dropped down on all fours and became uncivilized. Today we see the Ibanoid women's emulating the albinoid's women dressing half naked, nude on social media because she's uncivilized. And they taught you that civilization because Yakub taught them to destroy you. And they destroying the Ibanoid's women mentally. You're emulating them. You're uncivilized, sis. It's the duty of a civilized man. So I'm here to civilize an 85er. They became savage beasts. And they lost all sense of shame. And they started going nude in the winter. They wore animal skins for clothes. And they grew hair all over their faces and their bodies like the other wild animals. Yakub's albinoids started walking on their hands and their feet like all animals. And they learned to climb trees as well as any other animal. At night, they would climb into the trees and carry large stones and clubs to fight the wild beasts. So the scriptures say in the book of Job 30 verse 5, it reads thus: and they were driven forth from amongst men. And they were driven forth from amongst men. They cried after them as after a thief, to dwell in the cliffs of the valley, in caves of the earth, and in the rocks. Among the bushes they brayed, under the nettles they were gathered together. He was doing that to stay warm. They were children of fools, yea, children of base men. They were viler than the earth. And now I am their song. I am their byword. That's the book of Job. So at night, They will climb up in trees, carrying large stones, and climb to fight the wild beasts. Yakub's abunui turn. They tame the wolves. This is what the dogs came from. Thus the term man's best friend. Really mankind's best friend. So they tame the wolves and dogs to live in the caves with them. And after some times, the dog held a high place among their families, becoming their best friend. After 2,000 years of living in the caves, the wickedness of Yakub's abunuids was observed. And an ebonoid man named Moshe, or in the Arabic, Musa, was sent to civilize them. Moshe, or Musa, led Yakub's abunuids out of the caves. Once out of the caves, Yakub's abunuids kill Moshe. Free from the caves, Yakub's abunuids went on a rampage. Throughout the earth, conquering, subjecting the ebonoid people, putting one against the other, using ideas of divide and conquer. Yakub's abunuids would rape ebonoid women. This is how STDs were spread throughout the ebonoid community, created mixed offsprings with confused identities. Yakub's abunuids began to execute Yakub's plan for them to rule the world for 6,000 years. A man named Hamdu attempted to teach Yakub's abunuids to convince them to end their devilishment. However, this was still 1,400 years before the end of Yakub's abunuids' 6,000-year period of dominion over the earth. And so Yakub's abunuid ruled the earth for 6,000 years, spreading their devilishment, evil, pain, suffering, oppression, wars, diseases to the ebonoid people of the earth, as designed by the big head scientist Yakub. The events of Yakub occurred on the earth approximately 6,600 years prior to this message right here. And the 24 wise elder scientists of the inner earth foresaw and prophesied the birth of Yakub 15,000 years prior to Yakub being born. The 24 wise elder scientists of the inner earth was aware of the birth of Yakub, and they were aware of the things Yakub would do before Yakub was even born. The 24 wise elder scientists of the inner earth predicted that in the year 8400, this man Yakub would be born. And when this man is born, he would change civilization and the world and produce a new tribe of people who will rule the original ebonoid people for 6,000 years, from 9,000 year to the year 15,000. After 6,000 years rule of Yakub's people, the ebonoid people would give birth to one whose wisdom, knowledge, and power would be infinite. One whom the world would recognize as being the greatest and the mightiest since the creation of the UNIverse, the universe. And Yakub's old, warring, wicked world would be removed and destroyed, and the ebonoid nation would be restored into power to rule forever and to establish a world of peace and righteousness. This great redeemer of the ebonoid people was predicted and prophesied by the 24 elder scientists of the inner earth to bring balance back into the world. Is known under the name of many titles and attributes, including he who has no equal. He who there never was anyone like, the supreme being, the mighty, the wise, the best knower, the light, the life giver, the God, the all-powerful, he who knows how to reproduce the you in I verse, the universe, and the people of his choice. But his mother calls him Yishma. Yishma was a son of Princess Rydia of the Shaku family and Prince Hatif, the Sien family. Yishma's parents, Princess Rydia and Prince Hatif, married each other in order to establish peace between the Kurwan tribes. However, this union of Princess Rydia and Prince Hatif was more than mere chance. Their union was specifically guided and selected by the 24 elder scientists of the inner earth, who were also eugenicists, genetic engineers. And they knew that the offspring of the union between the Princess Rydia and Prince Hatif would be the personification of order, balance, out of the offset of the chaos. Yakub, who was the offspring of Yishak and Princess Lucina. Yishma began his education on the day he was born, as the custom amongst the members of the Shayuk. It would be unheard of for a member of the Shayuk to wait until the age of 4 to start school unless the child was mentally handicapped or retarded. Being part of the Shayuk and part of the Shinin, Yishma's head was noticeably larger than the other members of the Shayuk and Shin. Yishma had an enormous head, two brains, and a third enlarged pineal gland which sat in the center of his two brains, making the top of his head his peering to be shaped like a three orb. Amongst the Shayuk and Sinan, Yishma would be called the big head scientist, just like Yakub caught that rock. However, amongst these tribes, the statement was not taken to be an insult, but rather a compliment, alluding to the individual's intelligence, in the same way as saying, "Yo, my man, you got big muscles," alludes to the individual's strength. Since Yishma was raised in his native land amongst his people who looked like him, he did not suffer the same ridicule, mockery, and low self-esteem which plagued his cousin Yakub, who grew up in a foreign land amongst other than self and Khan. As a child, Yishma was an exceptional prodigy and a genius. Yishma was also told stories of the evil activities which transpired at the hands of his cousin Yakub. One day when Yishma was 9 years old, he was playing with two electromagnetics in the home of his grandfather, King Fruqua, and he noticed the electrons flowing in the same direction through two electromagnetics would create the magnetic phenomenon of attraction, and the electrons flowing in opposite directions through two electromagnetics would create a magnetic phenomenon of repulsion. By observing this, Yishma realized, like flowing energies create attractions, unlike flowing energies create repulsions. Thus, Yishma was inspired with a determined idea to direct the flow of mental energies of the Ebonoid people of the planet in the same direction so that the Ebonoid people of the planet would be unified again, to be strong and righteous, and bring peace and balance back to the earth forever. Upon coming to this realization, Yishmael looked up at his grandfather, King Fuqua, and said, "Grandfather, when I get older, I'm going to make a people strong and righteous, and I will eliminate the devilishment which has come into the world to show forth real power and wisdom and bring back peace and supreme balancement forever." Grandfather Farouk said, "What will you make? Someone to establish order and cause harmony in the world?" Yishmael said, "Man plans and I plan, and surely I am the better planner." And it was at that moment that the boy Yishmael first came to the knowledge of just who he was, born to establish order, bring peace, build, create, to be the redeemer to the Ebonoid peoples of the earth. It is common for members of the Shayuk tribe to finish all of the course of their work taught in all their colleges and universities of the surface world by the age 9, but Yishmael finished by age 7. If it took a member of the Shayuk tribe until age 18, as they do here on earth, to finish all of their coursework taught in all their colleges and universities of the surface world, then that people would surely be looked at as being mentally handicapped or mentally retarded. Yishmael finished all of the advanced universal sciences which are taught by the schools in the inner earth by the time he was age 12, even though it was common to finish coursework by the age 15, but Yishmael was a genius and a prodigy. After finishing school, Yishmael met with the 24 wise elder scientists of the inner earth and told them of his intention to travel to the surface world as a beginner, bringer of peace, and redeemer of the Ebonoid people. Yishmael was tried and tested by the 24 elder scientists of the inner earth, and once found worthy, at the age of 18, Yishmael traveled to every presently known and area presently known as Mwanza region, near the countries of Tanzania, Uganda, Kenya, and Africa. Yishmael called this doctrine Teachnology. Yishmael called this doctrine Teachnology. And his holy book was called the Book of Teachnology, 720, which is in a question and answer format designed to get the mentally incompetent to be competent, designed to get the mental energies of the listeners flowing in the same direction, which would in turn create unity, harmony, and attraction amongst kindred. Yishmael's new doctrine was so powerful that he had millions of people from all of the tribes of the earth coming to hear his message and aspiring to be part of his mission. However, from the millions of followers that he gained on the surface of the earth, Yishmael only selected 144,000, which he called the chosen few, to be part of the next phase of his plan. And when Yishmael and his chosen few departed, he told the people of the surface of the earth, "I will be back in one day." So Yishmael selected 41,150 Ebonoid females, 41,140 Ebonoid males, for a total of 82,290 people from the original Ebonoid tribe, 10,000 Rubenoids females, 10,285 Rubenoid females, 10,285 Rubenoid males, for a total of 20,570 people from the Rubenoid tribe, 10,285 citronoid females, 10,285 citronoid males, for a total of 20,570 people from the citronoid tribe, and 10,000 albinoid female, 10,285 albinoid females, 10,285 albinoid males, for a total of 20,570 from the albinoid tribe, which made 144,000 people totally. Ishmael took his followers into the center of the earth through an opening beneath the Great Lake in the present-day area known as Wanza region in Africa to begin his eugenics genetic engineering experiment of grafting the various tribes of people of the earth back into the original Ibanoid tribe. Ishmael began being a master genetic engineer who was all wise, right and exact, knew that it was not necessary to kill anyone in order to accomplish his goal, because he had knowledge of the science of dominant and recessive genes. Knowing that the Ibanoid tribe was the first, then Ishmael knew that the Ibanoid gene would be the most dominant, followed by the Rubenoid gene, followed by the Citronoid gene, followed by the Albinoid gene. While inside the inner earth of his followers, Ishmael applied the science of the dominant recessive gene to design an engineered system of arranged marriages by which the offspring born from each arranged marriage would have sensual desired qualities. And in time, over a period of 900 years, all of the derivative tribes would have been grafted back to the original Ibanoid tribe. Ishmael observed that the gene of the Ibanoid woman was most dominant gene, and so Ishmael established the following rules of arranged marriages amongst his followers. The 10,285 Ibanoid women and 10,285 Ibanoid men would marry to keep the Ibanoid gene pure. 10,285 Ibanoid women would marry 10,285 Rubenoid men, 10,285 Citronoid men, 10,285 Albinoid men, and vice versa. 10,285 Ibanoid men would marry the Rubenoid women, the Citronoid women, and the Albinoid women. Grafting back to the original Ibanoid. The men and women were required to get married by age 18, and each couple were to have two children living in the inner earth where he was from. Ishmael was continuously rejuvenated and did not die like his cousin Yakub on the surface of the earth. Ishmael was able to teach, socialize, laugh, play with the children, enjoy life, and observe the generational progress of his followers over the centuries. The offspring of the Ibanoid women and the Ibanoid men would always be Ibanoid. The offspring of the Ibanoid woman and the Rubenoid man would also be Ibanoid because of the strength of the Ibanoid woman's gene. The offspring of the Ibanoid woman and the Citronoid would be Ibanoid 75% of the time and Rubenoid 25% of the time because of the strength of the Ibanoid woman's gene. The offspring of the Ibanoid woman and the Albinoid man would be 75% of the time and 25% Citronoid of the time because of the strength of the Albinoid woman's gene. The offspring of the Ibanoid man and the Rubenoid woman would be 75% of the time and Rubenoid 25% of the time. The offspring of the Ibanoid man and the Citronoid woman would be Rubenoid the offspring of the Ebonoid man and the Albinoid woman would be Sichenu. With the laws of arranged marriages in place, it would take Yishmael's chosen 144,000 people, 46 generations, over the course of 900 years to be grafted back into the original Ebonoid tribe. During this time, for some generations, recessive genes would tumble forward. After 12 generations of all the Albinoids had been gathered back into the Sichenoid, Rubenoid, and Ebonoid tribe. After another 16 generations of all the Sichenoids had been grafted back into the Rubenoids and Ebonoids. After another 18 generations, all the Rubenoids had actually been grafted back into the Ebonoids, leaving only the original Ebonoid tribe. It was also observed that after 4 generations, if the Albinoids refused to mix, then they would be unable to conceive offsprings after the 4th generation. After 8 generations, if the Sichenoids refused to mix in, they would actually be unable to conceive the offsprings after 8 generations. After 16 generations, if the Rubenoids refused to mix in, they would be unable to conceive offsprings after the 16th generation. Just like the electrons flowing from the atoms, with more electrons to atoms with fewer electrons, it was necessary for the derivative tribes to mix back into the original Ebonoid tribe in order to be recharged and to sustain and maintain their existence. However, because of the science of the recessive and dominant gene, by mixing back into the original Ebonoid tribe, the derivative tribes would eventually be grafted back into the original Ebonoid tribe in time, leaving only the Ebonoid tribe on the surface of the planet. As it was in the beginning, so shall it be in the end. And so Yishmael smiled at the fact, now having knowledge that the evil acts done by the cousin Yakub would be reversed just by letting nature take its course. The process of grafting the derivative tribes back into the original Ebonoid tribes took 900 years. And once completed, Yishmael took another 100 years to teach and train his followers how to control and to conquer the evil which existed within themselves, rather than attempting to grab the evil out, letting it manifest as a being. After the 100-year period, with Yishmael in the inner earth, returned to the surface of the earth to the area presently known as Wanza region in Africa, with 144,000 Ebonoid people. When Yishmael and the 144,000 followers returned, the people on the surface of the earth said, "Yishmael, you said you would actually be gone for one day, and you were true to your word. You've only been gone one day, but many of the people have returned with you are not the people you left with. What have you done with our brothers and sisters?" One of the Ebonoid women, Kadara, who was one of Yishmael's wives, and one of the 144,000 spoke up and said, "I'm the daughter and the great descendant of your brother and sisters. What seems to you left with Ishmael just yesterday, but we've been with Yishmael in the inner earth for 1,000 years. Well, he has taught us the science of genetics and how to rid the world of evil, as well as to conquer the evil within ourselves." Yishmael spoke and said, "Indeed, one day in the inner earth can be like 1,000 years. Yishmael's followers then proceeded to teach the Ebonoid people on the surface of the earth the way to defeat the evil currently plaguing the earth in the same way that Yishmael taught them. Yishmael returned to the inner earth with his Ebonoid wife, Kadara, and spoke up in defense of him. After returning to the inner earth, Yishmael was elected to a seat as one of the 24 elder scientists of the inner earth. Yishmael taught Kadara the secrets of eternal life, and they had many children together. Yishma told Kadara that the Ebonoid woman and the human is the human representative of nature on the surface of the earth, and thus the Ebonoid woman is a key to destroying the evil plague in the surface of the earth and bring peace and balance back to the surface of the earth. Yishma told Kadara that it was not him who was the 24 wise scientists of the inner earth had prophesied about. It was her, the Ebonoid woman. Yishma told Kadara that he was merely a conduit to allow her to bring balance back to the earth. And so while the big head scientist Yishma followers executed his plan on the surface of the earth, Yishma and Kadara wait with their family in the inner earth for the hereafter, that is to say, here on earth, after evil has been removed and peace and balance has been restored on earth afterwards. I'm Kahan Tells It Doc, and this is White Knowledge for Real. And this is the story of Yakub, the big-headed scientist, and Yishma, the big-headed scientist. You can like it, understand it, believe it or not. I highly encourage you to share it. I am the Deprogram Enlightener, a seer, a priest, a prophet. I am one who has been sent. You're in the valley of decision of what you like to believe. Remember to subscribe for more videos like this to open up your mind and more light knowledge for real. Now, it is time that I say shalom.